feisty, fearless, and fair. She's an Emmy-winning journalist from the White House to war zones, telling all sides of the story. This is the Rita Cosby Show.
Lovely Rita, meet a maid. Nothing can come between us. When it gets dark, I tow your heart away.
Breaking news.
And tonight on the Rita Cosby Show, well, federal prosecutors have now formally charged suspect Ryan Routh with attempted assassination of President Trump. This is a very big deal because, of course, it comes after there has been pressure from President Trump and others saying, what is taking them so long? Remember, they were very, very absent and MIA, if you will, and stonewalling, according to a lot of different members of Congress, on the first assassination attempt. And in just the past few hours, the federal authorities have upgraded their charges. And now the Justice Department says that, yes, Ryan Routh methodically plotted to kill the Republican nominee, aiming a rifle through, of course, the shrubbery surrounding that West Palm Beach golf course where President Trump was playing, and also that there was information, remember, in his car. Apparently, he had multiple passports, multiple cell phones, also had a Google search of how to travel from Florida to Mexico. So he clearly was a flight risk. And boy, oh boy, oh boy, this will be interesting because now the battle begins between the feds and also state authorities. We know that Florida, vis-a-vis Governor Ron DeSantis, that they are also pursuing some major charges against this same 58-year-old man. So what questions do you still have tonight surrounding this case? Of course, the UN is meeting this week in New York. There are folks from all over the globe and lots of questions about Iran. And there are still many questions surrounding Iran with this guy. How did he somehow recruit fighters from Afghanistan to try to bring them to Ukraine vis-a-vis Iran? And then in one of his messages, he wrote essentially to Iran, I'm so sorry. You can kill me and you can kill President Trump. Of course, Iran has had a targeted assassination attempt against President Trump. We've heard about that quite a bit of late. And we found out about that Pakistani guy who crossed the border soon before the Butler, Pennsylvania rally. So there are so many questions tonight. And what questions are still lingering in your mind about this case? Because you still have to wonder, did he act alone? Will they actually pursue if indeed there were others involved? We know, again, in that first case, remember the Thomas Matthew Crooks, the 20-year-old, well, his body was cremated. Why was it cremated so quickly? And also, he was looking at these foreign apps. What was he looking at in terms of foreign apps? We don't know. We don't know the information. And not only do we not know, but Congress doesn't know. That's actually investigating into all of this. Whether we should know or not, the president should certainly know, and members of Congress on the task force should definitely know about this. But I will say at least it's a step in the right direction that at least they're finally taking this second assassination attempt seriously. And thank goodness the feds are feeling some heat because it's clearly because President Trump has come out in the last few days and said that he doesn't necessarily trust them to do an unbiased investigation. Would you trust Merrick Garland's DOJ to do an unbiased investigation, given the way that he has turned a blind eye on so many things tied to President Trump or pushed for things against President Trump? Look how many things have happened with the classified documents, the appointment of Jack Smith, all the immunity stuff that's come about that has saved President Trump, that decision from the Supreme Court. I think it's the right move. Also, all the January 6th stuff, and we have some blockbuster stuff about that tonight. That paints a very different light. We did a big interview with John Solomon today, and boy, oh boy, wait till you hear that. That is going to knock your socks off. But I don't blame President Trump for being apprehensive and saying, can I trust DOJ, Biden's DOJ? It's the same DOJ that said, oh, you're fine. You have enough security. Oh, I'm sorry. Did you have a second assassination attempt? And then they barely even brought it up. So it wasn't until President Trump started putting some heat on DOJ. He's always been praising the Secret Service agents themselves, the men and women, because he knows that they literally are putting their lives on the line for him. There's no question about it. And they have done great work. But it's the leadership and also the leadership of DOJ. And what about the leadership of Department of Homeland Security, Alejandro Mayorkas? That guy is a mess. He oversees not only the border. Is there anybody who would give him a grade higher than an F there? But he also oversees Secret Service and the leadership of the Secret Service and making sure that people are held accountable. And he hasn't done anything. Where is Mayorkas? We haven't seen him. Where is he? He has been completely MIA after all of these assassination attempts. And sadly, there have been more than one, as you know. So this is really scary. But luckily, President Trump has been keeping the heat on DOJ, and also Ron DeSantis, to his credit, down there in Florida, the governor came forward and said, yeah, we'll look into it. Florida's going to look into it because we want to make sure that it's done correctly. And he said that his men and women were getting stonewalled when they showed up at the Florida golf course trying to look for clues for their case. But Ron DeSantis says they are doing a parallel investigation. And there is no doubt that this result that just came down a little bit ago, again, federal charges formally against Ryan Routh, the attempted assassin of President Trump. Thank goodness they are finally feeling a little heat and a little fire under the belly. You cannot have two attempted assassinations against a former president of the United States. And the DOJ and the president of the United States and the vice president, they should all be pounding their fists. And they have not been doing that. They've been ignoring it. Many of them have been increasing the rhetoric against him and putting him in further danger. Then they released that letter the other day, as if anybody doubted that the guy was trying to assassinate President Trump. What did they think? He was over there walking his dog or something for 12 hours? That's preposterous. But releasing that letter in many ways has inspired a lot of people to maybe do a copycat. And that's the scary part, because that letter essentially says, hey, I'll put a bounty on his head. I'll do this. I'll do that. And a lot of people have been deeply concerned about that letter coming out. There are still so many unanswered questions in this case. I really do want to know, how did he get like the weaponry? How was he traveling back and forth to Ukraine to essentially be a mercenary over there? And also, all these different agencies that got reports about this guy, the FBI, the CIA, the Department of State, Homeland Security, they were getting reports from different people saying there's this loony kazoony guy over here in Ukraine making these statements, bringing in these things, bringing in black ops and weaponry, that black market, and reporting him and saying also that he's threatening world leaders. And yet he's still allowed to kind of travel unfettered. Does that make any sense to any of us? I don't think so. So was he being helped by somebody or some country or some group? There's a lot of questions tonight. And also, apparently he left that letter that I was just telling you in the box of a neighbor or a friend. Who was this neighbor or friend? I'd like to know more. And what kind of a person says, yeah, sure, I'll hold this stuff with you. I'm not going to open it up. No worries. I'll put some, you know, we'll put some guns and some other things. And will you just hold this for me for a little bit? And the guy said he just opened the letter and it talked about the threats to Trump and it talked about the threats to others. The letter is chilling. And I do think it's important evidence against the guy. But who was this person who was holding it? Doesn't it beg a lot more questions than answers tonight? And why didn't they just press charges the first day? It'd be pretty easy to do it. I think anybody could have done it in about 5 minutes. 1-800-848-9222. 1-800-848-9222. Here is Merrick Garland a little bit ago, kind of teasing that these charges were about to come. Take a listen.
Mr. Attorney General, I'm sure you'll get some questions about visa, but respectfully, I'd like to ask you about former President Donald Trump. The former president yesterday put out a statement who was critical of your Justice Department. He said the Kamala Harris, Joe Biden Department of Justice and FBI are mishandling and downplaying the second assassination attempt on my life since July. The charges brought against the maniac assassin are a slap on the wrist. And then he ends, sir, with, in all capital letters, let Florida handle the case. What's your reaction to that?
The attempted assassination on the former president was a heinous act. I'm grateful that he's safe. And as I said, immediately after the event, the Justice Department would spare no resource to ensure accountability in this matter. Since then, our prosecutors and agents, only 10 days ago, our prosecutors and agents have been working around the clock to discover the necessary evidence to ensure accountability. In just the last few days, new information was developed, and it was put in evidence in the court for the detention hearing, which was necessary to ensure in the short term that the defendant in the matter would not be released while the investigation continues. As the United States said in that detention hearing, further additional charges will soon be filed. All of our top priority should be ensuring that accountability occurs in this case and that those who run for office and their families are safe and protected.
Does that sound like a guy who really has fire in the belly? Doesn't sound like it to me, even now after all of this. But yet, a few hours later, indeed, they did press charges. And here is Carrie Urban. She was on Fox earlier, and she worked for Bill Barr, then Attorney General under President Trump. And this is what she said. She said, boy, oh boy, there are still a lot of mysteries surrounding this case.
Oh, there are major open questions here. This is a fascinating case. Six cell phones, immediate red flags. I'd love to know, and hopefully we'll find out at some point, what were on all those cell phones. Even this friend, Martha, the friend that he dropped this box off, you know, with the ammo and the letter, who is this friend? Why did he feel comfortable, you know, giving this to his friend? And why did he trust this friend not to open the box before, you know, something happened? I'd want to know everything about this friend and if this friend is working with someone else. And on Iran, yes, you know, we hear a lot about his interest in Ukraine and pro-Ukraine, but it's rare to hear someone who has that interest plus some kind of fondness, it seems, for Iran. The fact that he wrote in his self-published book, Iran, I'm sorry for, you know, voting for Donald Trump, you should assassinate me and the president, the former president. And then, of course, in his letter to the world, he talked about Iran as well as a motivating factor in why he tried to murder him. Very interesting, very bizarre, and a lot of questions. I would want to know, if I was a federal investigator right now, are there any actual ties to Iran beyond just his words?
That's a great question. That's a great point. How could he continue to bring in Iran? And there's some new details on President Trump being briefed on the threat from Iran, all of these things coming together. Do you believe in just mere coincidences? I don't think so. 1-800-848-9222. 1-800-848-9222. Let's go to Reggie in Texas. Reggie, you're here on the Rita Cosby Show. Go ahead, Reggie.
Hey, good evening there, Rita. I think the first and foremost question is, in the letter, he talks about, in one of those letters, he talks about the $150,000 that he makes available to whoever can finish the job. It doesn't look like that's the kind of money he had hanging around.
Yeah, that's a great point. That's a great point. And apparently he had like $300 in his like bank account. How does a guy like that get $150,000? And who was he in touch with? We haven't heard, who was he in communication with? He seemed like a pretty jovial guy. He was going around talking to a lot of people, especially people who met him over in Ukraine and elsewhere. So, right, where's that $150 coming from? Did somebody actually say, hey, I'll give you $150, or some government say that? Right? What do you think, Reg?
Well, no, I think that's a great point. It's not like he can go on Indeed and ask for job applications as to who can make a hit on a president. So, obviously, something's going on there with influence. And the other thing, too, Rita, is I don't know how much airtime this is getting, but his phone pinged at that location on multiple times, multiple days. He was staking that area out quite a bit. It's just amazing that in an area where the former president golfs would have that kind of a security lapse.
Yeah, you hit it right? on. And by the way, Reggie, you hit a great point because you're right. It wasn't just that one day. Apparently, he had been hanging out there and near Mar-a-Lago, his home, not just the golf course area, but his home, too. And even that day, we know he was there 12 hours, but apparently he had been there quite a bit. And why wasn't he on the radar? Wouldn't they notice him the other days, too? 1-800-848-9222. We'll continue your calls, everybody, after the break.
The Rita Cosby Show. It's the Rita Cosby Show.
The feds have now formally charged Ryan Routh, who is involved in that attempted assassination of Trump in Florida. Also, we are just getting word, this is coming from the Trump campaign, that they have been updated on, quote, real and specific threats from Iran to assassinate the Republican presidential candidate, that they were briefed on that. The communications director for the Trump campaign saying that Iran's aim to assassinate Trump is part of the Islamic Republic's efforts to destabilize and sow chaos in the United States, furthering that intelligence officials have identified these continued and coordinated attacks have heightened in the past few months. And law officials across all agencies are working to ensure that President Trump is protected and the election is free from interference. Also further saying, quote, make no mistake, the terror regime in Iran loves the weakness of Kamala Harris and is terrified of the strength and resolve of President Trump. Powerful messages, again, coming from the Trump campaign. Word that they are being briefed of continuing and specific real threats from Iran. And boy, that's pretty scary because the Iranian president was speaking at the UN. Talk about timing of all this. And of course, the most important thing, President Trump needs to be safe.
Rita Cosby is on. The Rita Cosby Show presents Back the Blue.
And this Back the Blue segment is sponsored by GoyaCares.com. Because you are a precious gift from God. And this very powerful story coming from Virginia Beach, Virginia, where a police department spokesperson says that two people were rescued from the water. The beachgoers said that they noticed that there was a young girl playing in the waves with another child. Then they heard a scream and a strong ocean current pulled the girl away. We were just screaming, "We're coming to get you. We're coming to get you." But then they said that they tried to grab the girl and she was pulled several feet into the water. So then they had the two children that were in the ocean. Then they decided to call 911. The police, they said, thank goodness, came so fast. I have to give them credit for that. They were still out there for maybe 10, 15 minutes treading water, trying to keep their heads up. And they luckily survived. Thank goodness to the chief of the Virginia Beach Life-Saving Services. Well, they commended also two Samaritans, two good Samaritans, who then first made the call, but also helped law enforcement in their efforts. The chief of Life Saving Services says it's important for all bystanders to remember to never go into the water to try to physically save them because they could also become victims themselves. By the way, the rescue comes just 1 week after Virginia Beach lifeguards ended their watch for the summer season. Thank goodness, though, the local police department was able to respond very, very quickly. These two kids were taken to the local hospital. They are both in stable condition and expected to be okay. So thank goodness there is a very, very happy ending. Well, we are talking, of course, about this latest detail. First off, chilling words again coming tonight from the Trump team about these threats from Iran. Very serious threats. They're saying they are real and specific threats from Iran to try to assassinate President Trump, and that they have been told about increased attack efforts and stepped up coordinated missions happening in the last few months as we are headed toward the election. Clearly, Iran seems to want Kamala Harris. And quote, according to the Trump team, they are terrified of the strength and resolve of President Trump. And in the press release that they put out, they also said President Trump will let nothing stop him or get in his way to fight for the American people and to make America great again. Imagine you are dealing with not just threats from this guy like Ryan Routh, the other guy, of course, in Butler, Pennsylvania, but now you also have Iran. And recently we talked with Andy Biggs, the congressman of Arizona, who was talking not just about Iran, but he was talking about potential hit teams from Ukraine and from Russia, too. In the middle of all this, this is a very scary and dangerous time for America. And boy, does the Secret Service need to be top of their game. Today, President Trump was in Georgia, one of the swing states, big swing state, of course, in this election. And he described the woman who actually broke the case. This is really interesting. He talked about the fact that, remember when Ryan Routh, when he got spotted by the Secret Service guy, and of course the agent opened fire on him, he saw the muzzle popping through the bushes, remember, at the fence line. So he opens fire on him, and then he runs away. And there was a bystander there. It was a woman who saw Ryan Routh running away, luckily got a shot of the vehicle, saw the license plate, also was able to get a good description of him because that person was able to ID him when authorities got him on the highway not too long after that. But President Trump described the moment and just how incredible it was that a bystander stepped up and literally helped to get this guy. Take a listen.
He then ran across the street, down the block to get his car. Only a woman could do this because men aren't smart enough, okay? And a woman, pretty busy road, Congress, it's called, and pretty busy, but she didn't like the way he looked. Now, I see people running all the time. I don't like the way they look, but I don't follow them. She didn't like the way he looked. He looked very suspicious. He was running like wild because he had to get away from the Secret Service, and his car was about a block away. She followed him, stopped right behind his car, and started taking pictures of his license plate. Who would do that? And I asked our great sheriffs in Palm Beach, I said, so if this happened 1,000 times, how many times would somebody follow somebody and take pictures of the license plate? He said, maybe none. That's right. I mean, that's luck too, and or something. But this woman is incredible. And once they had the license plate, they had him in a high-speed chase down the highway. But once they had the license plate, it was over. If they didn't have the license plate, he would still be out there. I wouldn't be very comfortable. I would say, I wonder if he's in this audience. I'd say, where is this lunatic? But this woman was, what she did was amazing. So I've had a very interesting experience for the last couple of months. My profession is a very dangerous one.
It sure is. And it's obviously getting more and more dangerous by the moment. Also, President Trump at that same rally saying that, boy, God was looking out for him that day. Take a listen to how he described his emotions.
I said, let me see the chart. Bring it down. That was a lucky one, but maybe not lucky. Maybe right up there. Maybe not lucky. He looked at me and said, "You are the luckiest man." I said, "No, maybe it's something else." But he couldn't believe it. You know the nicest thing when people say, "It was God, and God came down and he saved you because he wants you to bring America back." So many people say that.
Powerful message from former President Trump. 1-800-848-9222. Let's go to Pete. Pete, your thoughts about all this.
Hi, Rita. My thoughts are that we got to keep this man safe. This is the only chance we got to survive. They're afraid of him because he is tough. He is tough as nails. And these people in the White House right now are pushovers. And I wouldn't put it past them that they've been getting money and paid off to give away secrets and everything. Somebody had to know that he was at that golf course at that time. Something leaked out because he didn't make a habit of this. And it's terrible. Every night I say a prayer for President Trump, and I call him president. I respect the office with Biden and everything, but I don't feel safe. I really don't feel safe.
Well, it's a different world, by the way, Pete. Boy, is it a different world and a different attitude, too, right?
Oh, yeah. I'm scared to go in the subway. I'm scared to go into Manhattan now. You know, since I got my toe removed and the kidney cancer, I'm doing good with that. Everything's coming along. But I don't have the strength. And I'm approaching 70 years old.
Well, let me say one thing, Pete. First of all, Pete, you got a lot of strength. And second of all, also, you know, I don't think anybody feels safe on a New York City subway. I mean, that to me is something that no matter, I don't care who you are right now, to be on a subway, to even when you walk the streets of New York, there are just, and it's not just New York. It is so many cities across this country that have just gone downhill and degraded. And you look at also, there's a lot of reports today about all these migrant gangs, the Venezuelan gangs that have no fear, so much so that they don't hesitate to even shoot at police. And if that's the case, there are no rules and nobody is safe. If the police aren't safe, nobody is safe. Pete, thank you very much, my friend. I'm glad you're doing okay. We always love hearing from you. Let's go to Russ. Russ in White Plains. Your thoughts, Russ.
Hi, Rita. Have you considered where this guy, Ryan Routh, whether he had contacts with the same Ukrainian intelligence agencies that sponsored that attack 6 months ago on the Caucasus City concert hall in Moscow? Because they were criticizing this guy Routh as saying he had crazy ideas, that he wanted to bring Islamic extremists from Afghanistan, Tajikistan, those kind of places. And I think that the same kind of sniper techniques that Ruth was involved with were used in the 2014 Maidan sniper attacks in Kiev. I almost expected Victoria Nuland to show up with donuts and coffee for Ruth, because I think really it's the Ukrainians that don't want Trump to get in there, because he said it's going to be over. If I was in Iran...
So wait. Hang on, Russ. You're like connecting a million dots here. First off, that shooting at the Moscow theater, it was ISIS-K, and they were upset about Russian, taking territory from the Chechens. That was like, it was all back to that. And that was a mass coordinated attack. This is like one guy. By the way, I am not saying that I discount some other interference or some other group or something. But maybe there's something there. We just don't know. We have no idea. But I do find it odd that like the last caller talked about the bounty, putting up $150,000. Maybe he's just saying that, or maybe there is $150,000 somewhere. What about how is he traveling to Ukraine? How is he somehow getting Afghan fighters for Ukraine? And then some of them went via Iran and get stuck in Iran. I mean, there's a lot of tentacles here. I don't know whose tentacles, but there's definitely a lot of them. And it's worth looking into, and you can't just discount that it's nobody. I agree that it may be broader. I just don't know where to point the fingers, because it seems like this guy was literally all over the place. That's for sure. But Russ, thanks so much. Let's go to Jimmy. Jimmy, your thoughts.
Hi, Rita. I'm just wondering, like, I'm telling like all my Democrat friends who I have, you know, I lost a lot of them, but take a step back. You just mentioned that we have hit teams from Iran, from Ukraine, and from Russia going after Trump. Are they going after him because he's a threat to our democracy? Because that's all we hear. Or is it because he's a threat to these countries that are a threat to us?
Well, you're right. You bring up a great point. Go ahead.
Thank you. With Joe Biden and Obama giving all this money to Iran, freezing up all the money that was sanctioned. Now he's speaking at the UN with the president of Iran. What's going on here? Are they working with the U.S. government to go after Trump?
Well, two things. First off, obviously, the Iranian president, that's the weird thing about UN. It is UN territory at the UN, technically, and it's allowed to have everybody. I mean, we've had good, bad, and ugly talk there. We've had Castro speak. We've had Putin speak there. Not this time, obviously. Putin hasn't come, I think, since like 2015, but it is typical that they invite good, bad, and ugly to come if they are a world nation. But we don't know. But there's clearly, listen, with Iran, there's no doubt that Iran doesn't want Trump. Do you think they want Trump? He's the guy who took out Soleimani. He's the one who sent that message exactly. to them and said, see ya, you know. Look at how much I believe Biden and Kamala Harris have been coddling Iran. And in fact, one thing I found really stunning today, President Biden spoke at the UN. It was his last speech as a commander in chief there. It's 10th time. And he mentioned climate change 6 times, Jimmy, and he mentions Iran twice. I mean, you got to be kidding me. I mean, so there's no doubt. And as we just played those comments I showed you from the Trump team saying that they have been getting briefings. It's obviously a very serious threat, these Iranian guys. And thank goodness it wasn't an Iranian hit team outside that golf course. You know, imagine if they could, if it took them that long to spot that one guy, imagine if it was like a skilled hit team from Iran. That's a scary premise, right, Jimmy?
Oh, absolutely. We have to pray to God to keep Trump safe. We need him.
Yeah, he needs to stay strong because America needs to stay strong and the world needs it. Boy, oh boy, oh boy. And it is amazing that he is still standing after all these threats to him and the, you know, foresight and the, you know, vision, and also just to be able to function, knowing all these threats are out there and all the issues out there. And yet he is saying, no, I'm still fighting for the American people. But all these different things that are coming at him from every different direction and these crazies, you know, we don't know. Was Ryan Routh acting alone? Was Thomas Matthew Crooks, whose body was cremated after a few days, which is bizarre. Was he acting alone? We may never know, but I hope we do find out because he needs to know and the American public deserves to know. We're going to continue your calls, everybody, after the break. 1-800-848-9222. And you're listening to The Rita Cosby Show.
It's The Rita Cosby Show. This is The Rita Cosby Show.
And everybody, it is coming up soon. The big Tunnel to Towers Foundation walk run. It's coming up on Sunday, September 29th. And all of us right here at Red Apple Audio Networks are encouraging all of you awesome listeners to donate to our individual teams. So be sure to go to walk.ritacosbyonline.com. walk.ritacosbyonline.com. Click on my picture to donate and please help me raise the most money for the amazing Tunnel to Towers Foundation walk run. Let's never forget America's heroes and what they do for us. So let's raise lots of great money for veterans, our first responders, and also 9/11 victims. Whatever you can give, it is so appreciated. Tell your friends too as well. These are the final days leading up to the Tunnel to Tower walk run, and we love this event and obviously love the Tunnel to Towers Foundation. So whatever you can do in the next few days, guys, please do it. walk.ritacosbyonline.com. And by the way, in the next hour, we're going to talk about some new stunning details tied to January 6th. And also some big details coming in via Jack Smith and the January 6th case coming from the judge in the case, Tanya Chutkan, who, remember, knows Hunter Biden. Remember, they were like at the same firm. There's a lot of questions there, but we've got some big news on that, and we're going to share that in the next hour. Meantime, we are talking about these assassination attempts against former President Trump. 1-800-848-9222. 1-800-848-9222. Let's go to Robert in Brooklyn. Robert, your thoughts.
Hey, thanks for taking my call. Well, thank God Trump is okay. Now, first point is, how did this guy get the schedule of Trump? And he was there 12 hours. I mean, now, a good point, the good thing that happened is that Judge Eileen Cannon has been assigned to the case, and she's a very, you know, fair judge. She was going to dismiss the bogus case against Trump. And I just request, Rita, could you get Eli Crane on? He's a Navy SEAL sniper, a congressperson. He's a really expert.
I love Eli Crane. I know exactly who he is. You're right. He's a great guy. What, to get his perspective on this?
Yeah, it'd be great. If you get him on, also ask him about the SAVE Act, because they claimed the speaker that he was going to support the SAVE Act, but push came to shove. He didn't push it in the continuing resolution.
Yes, absolutely. You're right. I will definitely get Eli Crane on. He's terrific. In fact, earlier today, we talked to Brian Mast on Katz and Cosby, but we will get Eli Crane on here because he has some really interesting things to say, especially about that shooting. Remember, he went out to the site in Butler, Pennsylvania, where, by the way, President Trump is going back to in 2 weeks. That's the official word. Wow, wow, wow. Let's go to Steve in Malibu. Steve, your thoughts.
Yes. Hi, Rita. Thank you very much for the opportunity. Great show, by the way. Listen, I love Trump. I love Biden. I am non-political, but I'm going to take a 90-degree turn here. Satellite images, 60,000 satellites whirling around up there, and no real-time images. You can't even contract with NASA for this. So I'm wondering, the Butler event and the Florida event for Trump, where are the satellite images? Also 9/11, go down the line on this stuff.
Yeah, that's a good point. By the way, Steve, I'll even go to drones. Remember, they claimed that their drone wasn't working that day, which is really, I mean, you know, at least in the Butler PA case, it doesn't even sound like they attempted a drone at the Florida golf course. I mean, they don't even have that. But you know what? That's a great point. There's got to be some aerial views. That's a really, really great point. Let's go to Tony in Clifton. Tony, your thoughts.
Hi, Rita. So, you know, one thing that always gets my attention is when I hear Iran, as we all do. And so one of the things I've been thinking about is Iran and, number one, President Trump's account, which was hacked on his campaign. Whatever happened to that? My impression was that the information went from Iran to the Biden administration. Number two, when they hacked Iran, they also went into...
No, yeah, you're right. No, there's questions with Iran.